In the same way that we can generate random numbers from a given distribution, like the normal or the binomial distribution, we can sample not numbers, but random graphs from a collection or ensemble of random graphs. Just like different distributions of numbers give rise to different samples of numbers, different random graph models give rise to different kinds of random graphs. The simplest possible random graph model is the so-called Ehrlich-Reinl, also known as the ER graph model. This family of random graphs has two parameters, capital N and lowercase p. Here, the capital N is the number of nodes in the graph, and p is the probability for any pair of nodes to be connected by an edge. Here's one way to think about it. Imagine starting with n nodes and no edges. You can then go through every possible pair of nodes, and with probability p, insert an edge between them. In other words, you're considering each pair of nodes once, independently of any other pair. You flip a coin to see if they're connected, and then you move on to the next pair. If the value of p is very small, typical graphs generated from the model tend to be sparse, meaning having few edges. In contrast, if the value of p is large, typical graphs tend to be densely connected. Although the NetworkX library includes an Ehrlich-Reinl graph generator, we'll be writing our own ER function to better understand the model. This is also an opportunity for us to learn more about the NetworkX library, and it's also a step towards being able to implement a more complicated network model yourself, the kind of model that is not included in the NetworkX library. Our task is to implement an ER model as a Python function. Let's first see how to implement the coin flip just one time. To do this, we'll be using the SciP stats module, more specifically, a function called Bernoulli. We'll first import that from SciP stats, import Bernoulli. And then we can call this function. We'll be using the RVS method to generate one single realization, in this case, of a Bernoulli random variable. The only input argument is p, which is the probability of success. In this case, the outcomes are coded as zeros and ones. That means that p is the probability that we get an outcome 1 as opposed to outcome 0. Let's try this a couple of times. So as you keep repeating this, you'll get mostly zeros, but occasionally you'll get a 1 as well. Let's look at some informal pseudocode for our ER graph generator. Initially, I'm going to specify some number of nodes. We'll just go with 20. I'm going to fix p to be equal to 0.2. These are just some numbers for us to experiment with. The first step for us is going to be the creation of an empty graph. Create empty graph. The next step for us is to add all n nodes in the graph. We then would like to loop over all pairs of nodes and add an edge with probability p. So loop over all pairs of nodes and add an edge with probability p. Let's start turning our informal pseudocode into actual code. To create the empty graph, we'll be using nxgraph, and remember to spell graph here with a capital G. I'm going to be calling my graph G here. The next step is to add all n nodes in the graph. I can accomplish that with just one line by using the addNodesFrom function. One way to do this would be to construct a list containing the nodes 0, 1, 2, 3, and so on. An easier way is to use a range object. And we call that range object with argument n. In this case, we'll be adding nodes starting from 0 and ending at n minus 1. In other words, we will have added n nodes to our graph. The next step for us is to loop over all of our nodes. We'll do this using a for loop. Let's call it node 1. For node 1 in g dot nodes. Remember, an edge is a pair of nodes, so we actually need to nest another loop inside of our first loop. So in this case, we need a second for loop for node 2 in g.nodes. At this point, we have looped over all pairs of nodes, and the next step is to add an edge with probability p. To do this, we used Bernoulli function, Bernoulli.rvs, and we set the probability parameter p to be equal to p. Just to be clear here, the first p is the name of the keyword argument that we are providing. The second p here is the actual value of p, in this case, 0.2. If this returns 1, so we can ask if Bernoulli RVS is equal to true, we add the edge between node 1 and node 2. Here we can simplify our code a tiny bit. Let's look at the if statement a little bit more closely. Here on the left, we have Bernoulli RVS, which returns either 0 or 1. Then we're asking if that is equal to true. What happens in this case is that if the Bernoulli process returns a 0, that gets interpreted as false. In contrast, if it returns a 1, that gets interpreted as true. So in this case, this line will be run g.addEdge if and only if the Bernoulli process returns a 1 to us. Let's look at the Bernoulli function one more time. I just said that if the function returns a 1, that gets interpreted as true. Therefore, we do not need this explicit comparison if the value that it returns is equal to true. We can just omit that. In this case, the if statement will be true if the Bernoulli random variable is equal to 1. If it's 0, the if statement evaluates to a false. Let's try running our random graph. First, we add the values of the parameters. So n is 20, p is equal to 0.2. And in this case, everything looks good. I'm going to ask g.number of nodes to find out how many nodes I have. I have 20, which is what I expected. Let's try drawing that. If you're used to looking at networks, this graph will look too densely connected to be right. In fact, we have a subtle error in our code. Now we're considering each pair of nodes twice, not just once, as we should. Consider running through the two loops, one nested inside the other. Consider a situation where node 1 is equal to 1 and node 2 is equal to 10. In this case, we're considering the pair 1, 10. Now, if you move forward in that loop, there's going to be a moment where node 1 is equal to 10 and node 2 is equal to 1. In this case, we're considering the node pair 10, 1. But because our graph is undirected, we should consider each pair of nodes just one time. For this reason, we need to impose an extra constraint, such as node 1 less than node 2, or node 1 greater than node 2. Either additional constraint will force us to consider each pair of nodes just one time. We're going to modify the code, so we'll add if node 1 is less than node 2, and the Bernoulli process works out. Let's then try running our code. We can then draw this. And you may be able to see that the graph looks less dense. In fact, this is the correct implementation of the model. As our final step, let's turn this into a function. I'm going to call this ergraph, and it takes in two parameters, capital N and lowercase p. I'm using capital N and lowercase p here because that's the convention for this particular model. I add a docstring, which I will complete in a second, and I need to make sure to indent my code. The only line I need to add here is the return statement. We want to make sure to return the graph g to whoever calls this function. We'll wrap this up by finishing the doc string. We'll say generate an ER graph, and then we run the function. So now the function has been defined. Now we're ready to call this function. We can call it directly inside NXDraw. So I want to visualize this graph right away. So I need to call ER graph. I want to build this on 50 nodes using p equal to 0.08. I can also specify a couple of additional attributes for the draw. I'll say node size equal to 40 and node color is equal to gray. And let me just move this line here to the top. And while we're at it, we can save this. I'll just call this er1.pdf. We can then run our code. Let's then look for er1. And this is our own homemade Edo Shreni graph.